وأجل فرجه. السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي على في توحده ودنا في تفرده وجل في سلطانه وعظم في أركانه فطر الخلائك بقدرته ونشر الرياح برحمته ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين الذي سمي في السماء بأحمد وفي الأراضين بأبي القاسم المصطفى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد طب القلوب ودوائها ونور أبصارها وعلى أهل بيته الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد بهم نتولى ومن أعدائهم نتبرى إلى يوم القيامة عباد الله أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والشمس وضحاها والقمر إذا تلاها والنهار إذا جلاها والليل إذا يغشاها والسماء وما بناها والأرض وما طحاها ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها قد أفلح من زكاها وقد خاب من دساها آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. First of all, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once again for granting us with this opportunity and this moment to observe our weekly Eid, which is Juma. I first admonish myself and each and every one of you, respected brothers and sisters, mu'mineen and mu'minat, to have the consciousness of the teachings of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which we all know Quran refers to it as taqwa. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, as we all know, expect nothing from us but taqwa, which is consciousness. And hence, you find in so many verses of glorious Quran, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala remind us of the importance of taqwa and working towards improving the levels of our taqwa or the levels of our consciousness. The verses I've just quoted from glorious Quran are from Quran 91 verse 110, Surah Al-Shams. These verses are very important verses, and inshallah, our topic of discussion for today will focus on these 10 verses of Surah Al-Shams. And you know the theme of the month is spiritual education, tarbiyat al-ruhiyya. And we are in this holy month of Sha'baan. And this month, inshallah, will be leading us to the holy month of Ramadan. And no better topic to discuss and to remind ourselves with than to look at our spirituality and to look at ways and means of improving the levels of our proximity and nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If brothers and sisters will recall very well, last month I kept reminding myself and you on the importance of the holy month of Rajab, and that the month of Rajab marks the beginning of our spiritual journey, the beginning of our journey of soul towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that we are expected to begin seriously preparing for the holy month of Ramadan in the holy month of Rajab. Now, what you sometimes find within our communities, not all of course, is that when Ramadan is coming, instead of us focusing more on building our spiritualities and preparing for our spiritualities, we tend to think of other things which are of course important, but not more important than our spirituality. We tend to think of what is going to be iftar. We're going to think of the sports in Ramadan. We're thinking of how the families are going to be together in Ramadan. What will be the menu in Ramadan? These are very important, but they are not important compared to the essence of the holy month of Ramadan, which is your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our relationship with Allah is of great importance, and it is something that I and you must strive and work towards it. It is something, if you do not work for it, you'll not get there. Don't get carried away by saying that you pray every day 5 times, you recite Quran every day. That's just a glimpse of beginning with your spiritual journey. You need to get to that level where constantly you feel the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so therefore, what I'm going to do today, inshallah, and then we'll carry on with this discussion. Today, inshallah, I'm going to shed light on the importance of spiritual education. And I'm going to do it by looking at the angle of our system that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wants us to focus more when it comes to our spirituality. You know very well, we don't want to belabor the point on that. We are all made up of that spiritual component and that physical component. Our physical component is easy. We always take care about it. That is our body. So you have a car, you have a house, you have a nice, you know, clothes to wear, you have a work to do, you earn good amount of money. These are all the physical aspect, the physical dimension of our lives. And these are very, very important. We cannot live without them. But what is more important, that if you focus on it and take care of it properly, believe me or not, brothers and sisters, it will complement this physical dimension easily. That is your spirituality. That is your soul. You find that we often take care of this body. We often take care of our physical need. But the spiritual need, we do. But we don't give it the maximum attention it requires. And that is what I seek to do, inshallah, in this today and the coming weeks up until the holy month of Ramadan. And the ayah or the verses I quoted, you know the verses very well. I'm going to look at how important self is, nafs, which Allah made it our chief component of existence. Our body, as you know, is not the chief component of our existence. Our body is a subordinate. It's a abd, it's servant to our nafs, to our soul. If you take care of that nafs, then the body will be okay. There is something in spirituality they call at-tatabuq, bayna al-dakhili wal-kharij. There must be collaboration between your inner part and the outer part. And that collaboration begins from the inner part. If your inner part, which some scholars call it inner machine, meaning your soul, your nafs, if it is taken care of properly, the outside part will be okay. But you know, I and you, we are more worried about what will people say about our outside part. When the inner part is something that we really need to take care of, because sometimes a person may stink spiritually, but in the eye of people, you look good, but in the eye of Allah, you look something else. So that is why the inner machine is something that we really need to focus on. And you don't have to spend the whole day and the whole night focusing on it. You just have to be determined. You just have to make it priority. And if you make it priority, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will make it easy for us. So kindly allow me, let him quote these verses from the English translation so that we can take it one after the other. You know, first Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is saying, I swear by the sun and its brilliance. وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا. Then Allah says, وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا. He said, and the moon when it follows the sun. That's two. Three, Allah is saying, and the day when it shows it. And then he said, and the night when it draws a veil over it. And then he says, and the heaven and him who made it. Meaning Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And the earth and him who extended it. And then he says, and the soul and him who made it perfect. And he says, then he inspired it, meaning soul, to understand what is right and what is wrong. And then he said, he will indeed be successful who purifies it, meaning soul. I will come to that. And then at the end he says, and he will indeed fail who corrupts it. If you corrupt your nafs, your soul, you're gone. You can be the best person. That is why I personally, I don't agree with the notion that you can be a good person without being religious. I personally don't agree with that. Especially when we talk of Muslims. When you talk of non-Muslims, it's a different discussion. If you tell me you can be good without being religious, then where do you put Prophet Muhammad and Amir al-Mu'mini? They were good in their akhlaq because they were religious. Religion was what made them to be good. What is religion? It's Allah, is to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who are not Muslims, who are not believers, that's a different ball game. It's a universal principle to be a good person, that's fine. But you as a religion, because today you know there are Muslims, there are Shia, you say no. Don't tell me about religion, I'm a good person. So where do you draw the line between your religion and being a good person? Religion is to make you good. If religion is not to make me good, then I don't believe in that religion. The essence of religion is to make you a better person. So trying to differentiate between religion and akhlaq, I think is undermining religion. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to extract 9 points from these 10 verses to demonstrate to myself and you, brothers and sisters, the importance of nafs. That if we do not take care of our nafs, then you cannot call yourself someone successful in life. Our spirituality and yearning for God is very, very important. And we must try as much as we can to work on our spirituality and seeking closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, one narration of the Prophet mentioned that if you strive in the way of Allah, Allah will send tawfiq to you to say, take me the way you want to take me. Tawfiq meaning what? Blessing from Allah, inayat from Allah. Rasulullah is saying, if you strive towards Allah, you try to purify your nafs, you try to purify your soul, Allah will send you the tawfiq, the blessing. And the blessing will tell you, take me how much you want. Now the first point I want to discuss, if you examine these 10 verses of Surah Al-Shams, you realize that those of you who know Arabic, even if you don't know Arabic, it's something simple to understand. In Arabic, we have something we call Al-Qasam wa Jawabul Qasam. Oath and the response of the oath. Like we're sitting here together, I come, I said, Wallah! If I say Wallah, you should expect something from me. If I say Wallah and keep quiet, then what's the point? When I say Wallah, I swear by God. It means I want to say something very important. So when I say Wallah, I swear by God, this is what they call Qasam, oath. Then every oath requires Jawabul Qasam, the response of the oath. If you are well versed with the structure of Quran, you realize that these verses of Surah Al-Shams are very unusual. It doesn't happen in Quran like that. Whereby Allah will like have more than 6-7 oaths, but to say only one thing. It's unusual. If you verse with the Quran, you can go through Quran and you will tell me. You will find Allah will have an oath, I swear by day, and then he will mention the thing. It's only here whereby Allah, aqsam they call, the oath are about 6-7 oaths. And then after that, what did he say? Qad aflaha man zakkaha. He is indeed successful who purifies it. Purifies what? Yourself, your nafs. Allah says, by the sun, by the moon, by the day, by the night, by the heaven, by the earth. Then he said, you are indeed successful if you purify the soul. That tells you how important yourself is. It is a decision maker in your life, yourself. Akal doesn't take decision. Nafs takes decision. Many people think Akal take decision. Akal doesn't take decision. I was discussing with brothers. Akal only analyze and leaves you there. Intellect as power of analyzing, analytical power. If you think your intellect decide, then you're wrong. Me, I is self. That's what takes decision. That's why in spirituality, in Arfan, they said self and nafs is a dangerous zone. It can take you this way, it can take you that way. It's not an akal. Akal will analyze and tells you this is good, this is bad. Then decision is in the hand of nafs. So if you do not understand the role of your nafs, you'll always blunder in your life. So the first point is, all these oaths, I swear by day, I swear by this. Allah, what do you want to tell us? Allah said, I want to tell you that your nafs is important, that if you purify it, you are successful in my eye. And if you fail to look after it, you are a failure in my eye. That's one. Two, look at this. Allah mentioned everything in Alamul Madda. Everything in this world of materialism, Shams, sun, moon, day, night, heaven, earth. Why Allah mentioned all these things? You know why? Allah is trying to say, خَلَقْتُ الْأَشْيَاءَ لِأَجْلِكَ وَخَلَقْتُكَ لِأَجْلِي. Allah is trying to say, oh, insan, I created everything because of you, and I created you because of me. I created you because of me. One, Hadith al-Qudsi mentioned, oh, the son of Adam, I created everything because of you, and I come to you to benefit from it. Why do you run away from me? You may tell me you don't run away from God. You run. Because our spirituality is not important to us. Making names are important. Becoming fame are important. Spirituality, our community, sometimes we lack it. Seriously. And it's high time we work on our spirituality. So the second point is that Allah mentioning all these things, I swear by this. He's trying to say, oh, Yabna Adam, khalaqtul ashya'a li ajlik. I created everything because of you. So that you can use these things to get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because I created you because of me. You need to know me. You need to get close to me. Because you are my khalifa on the face of the universe. If I am Ar-Rahman, I want to see that Rahmaniyah in you. If I am Ar-Rahim, I want to see that Rahimiyah in you. If I am Ar-Rauf, I want to see that Raufiyah in you. That is the reason as to why I brought you to this earth. That's number two. Number three, the nafs here. There are so many discussions among scholars. You know, if you go into philosophical, spiritual discussions, there are discussions about nafs. We have nafsul nabatiyah, we have nafsul haywaniyah, we have nafsul insaniyah. And of course, insan is got nabatiya, he's got hawaniya, he's got insaniya. What do I mean by this? So you've got animal soul, you've got plant soul, and you've got human soul. In us, all these souls are in. Inshallah, we'll discuss it maybe next week or the other week. But here in this ayah, it's focusing on nafsul insaniya. Because why? Nafsul insaniya tatarattabu ala amaliha al-akabi wa thawab. Allah talking about your soul, you human being. Why? Because the action of your soul triggers punishment or reward from Allah. So the third point is that Allah is talking about your soul. And he's talking about my soul. Allah is telling us this nafs is crucial. Take care of it. in terms of how you approach life, in terms of how you do things. Take care of these nafs. It's very, very important. You fail to take care of it, you are zilch and zero in the eye of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's go to the fourth point, which is very interesting. And this Allama Tabatabai in volume 20 of Al-Mizan beautifully explained. That, again, those who know Arabic, you know we have what is called definite article and indefinite article in Arabic. Al-Nakira wal-Ma'rifa. And there is a difference between definite article and indefinite article. Nakira Ma'rifa. In a very simple term, what is definite article? Meaning something known. Indefinite, general, unknown. Meaning specification and generalization. Now, if you examine these verses, I really want you to pay attention, please, brothers and sisters. If you examine these verses very well, you realize that right from the beginning of the ayah, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا وَالشَّمْسِ. That sun, shams, there is an alif lam. Alif lam is lil-ma'rifi. It is for definite article. Arabic is very important language. It's definite, meaning Allah is specifically talking about sun. So there is alif lam. Then he said, wal kamari, alif lam, definite article. Wal nahari, alif lam, definite article. Wal layli, alif lam. Wal sama, alif lam. Wal ard, alif lam. When it comes to nafs, was there alif lam? Like he said, wa nafsi, not wa nafsi. You know why? It's nakira. What is nakira? Tafidul umum, yes, true. But that's not the only benefit of nakira. This indefinite article, the first benefit of the indefinite article is what? It's general, but that's not the only benefit. Dilala ala al-fakhama wal-azama. It indicates to the greatness and mightiness of something. When Allah reaches nafs, he said, wa nafsin wa ma sawaha. Meaning nafs is great, nafs is profound. Nafs is highly cherished by Allah. Otherwise, Allah would have said, wa nafsi, close. But he said, wa nafsin wa ma sawaha. That nakira, like sometimes I come into it, I said, al-muslimu. Sometimes I said, muslimun. Al-Muslimu, meaning I'm referring to maybe you or him. But Muslimun, maybe you, maybe him, maybe them. That Muslimun is more profound than Al-Muslimu. A Muslim, the Muslim, two different things. If I say the, I'm referring to you. Eh, it could be any one of you, isn't it? So here Allah, when it comes to nafs, he said, wa nafsin wa ma sawwaha. A soul, which soul? Maybe yours, maybe his. But here in Arabic, it means what? Profound. Very powerful. Very strong. Look at how Allah is talking about ourselves and our nafs and our soul. And the fifth point, if you dissect the verses again, and this you correlate it with what appears in Surah Al-A'la. Subhisma Rabbika Al-A'la. Verse number 2. What Allah said? Alladhi khalaqa fasawwa. This ayah said, wa nafsin wa ma sawwaha. Khalaqa fasawwa. Wa nafsin wa ma sawwaha. Same thing Allah is talking about. What is sawwaha? When he created it, he provided it with a balance. What is that balance? Alhamaha. Allah inspired. Fired the nafs. Proper. Ilham and nukati scholars mention. Not to go too deep into this. It's ilham, it's inspiration. Allah inspire you with a choice. That you are free to choose what you want. Although I will cherish if you choose that one. That is the fifth point. Wa nafsin wa ma sawaha. Alladhi khalaqa fasawwa. Meaning number one, there was ijad al-khilq. And then number two, there is taswiya. Allah first created the nafs, and after creating the nafs, it made it balanced by inspiring the nafs. Allah, what does he say in Quran?
وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي. نَفَخْتُ فِيهِ. I blew my spirit in him.
In what?
In his nafs.
Then after that, he said what? فَقَعُوا لَهُ سَاجِدِينَ. Isn't it? You then prostrate and respect him. One ayah said, after that, he said, فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنُ الْخَالِقِينَ. Glory be to Allah, who is the best of the creators. When did Allah say that?
When he created the nafs of insan. So your nafs is crucial. Imam Ali says, don't sell it cheap. We are selling our nafs cheap. And we are making our body and our materials expensive. Supposed to be the opposite. Don't sell your soul cheap. Your soul deserves nothing but Allah. It doesn't deserve anyone, anything. It deserves Allah.
The C point is what? This ayah and these verses completely eradicate the notion of aqidatul jabr. That Allah created us and forced us to do whatever we are doing. You know the discussion of determinism and predeterminism, destiny, free will, and whatever. This ayah alone, wa nafsin wa ma sawaha fa alhamaha fujuraha wa taqwaha. These two tells us we have a choice. You are not forced by Allah. You decide what you want to do and how you want to do it. The seventh point is what? The same verses, you can find it. If you look at the ayah, Allah said, "Kad aflaha man zakkaha." He is indeed successful. Who purifies? Who Allah is talking about? He's talking about you as insan, not the nafs. Meaning, if you take off the nafs, you become a good person.
It changes your akhlaq to be the best akhlaq. Aflaha man. Man haza is not ma. Man referring to insan.
Man zakkaha. You the one who strive in trying to purify these nafs,
you become better. You become good person.
You become person that not only human being cherish, but the angels cherish you also. And number eight, then we go to the last one. A point on these verses. Is that, you see, brothers and sisters, Allah Azza wa Jal, out of his love for us, he provided these nafs. And he wants us to work towards purifying these nafs. He doesn't just want us to do that. He provided us with mechanisms to do so. What is the mechanism? Zurara reported from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salam alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Inna lillahi hujjatayn. Hujjatun zahiri wa hujjatun batin. Said Allah has two proofs over us. The hidden proofs and the apparent ones. What is the hidden proof? The akal, intellect. And the apparent one, prophets, messengers, and imams. Allah provided us this to be able to analyze and take care of our souls. And that is why you find in Surah Al-An'am, verse 149,
"Kul falillahi al-hujjatul baligha, falaw sha'a lahadahum ajma'in." Said Rasulullah, tell them, "Falillahi al-hujjatul baligha." The greatest proof is with Allah. What is that proof? Your aql and the prophets. "Falaw sha'a," if Allah had wished, he would have guided all of them, but he gave them the choice. So when I talk of nafs, you have to strive. Nobody will strive for you. You have to work towards your nafs. Nobody will cook food for you and put it in your mouth. You have to enjoy this worship. Not when you come, mosque is boring. When you recite Quran, it's boring. When Ramadan comes, you are praying, the Ramadan comes to an end. You need to have that feeling. But the only way to have that feeling is to work for it.
And the same way Allah comes with in Quran again, Surah An-Nisa, isn't it? Verse 165.
Rusulan mubashirin wa mundhirin li'alla yakuna lin-nasi 'ala Allahi hujjatun ba'da ar-rusul.
So this prophet and messenger that we sent you, they are mubashirin wa mundhirin. They give you glad tidings and they warn you. so that no one will come on the day of Qiyamah to have a proof against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Prophet of Allah, they came to explain to us what is it that we need to do. That is why in our aqaid we are taught, prophets did not come to prove to us the existence of Allah, but they came to tell us that you have allowed dirtiness and rustiness to take over your nafs. Remove them and you will see Allah in everything. You don't need to be told about Allah. Promise me. It says that we allow so many dirtiness to overwhelm us. We are in measurement. We see only now. We don't see anything beyond. That is why things that are primary are becoming secondary to us, and things that are secondary are becoming primary to us. Wallah, the primary thing in our life, according to Islam, should be our nafs. And lastly, in conclusion, number 8, then we're done. Again, go to Quran. You see, Allah, Allahu Akbar, Quran is very powerful. Look at this ayah. He said, wa nafsin. Then he said, wa ma sawaha. If you go deep into the tafsir, this ayah alone, Allah talk about nafs, and then talk wa ma sawaha. This wa ma sawaha is talking about himself. Khalaka fasawwa. So he's talking about himself. Here, scholars said, there is an oath with insan and an oath with Allah. How? See, Allah in this nafs, one of sin. First oath is with nafs. And then second oath is with Allah. They said here, what do you get out of it? That if you want to get to Allah, you have to know yourself. One of sin. Then he said, wama sawa. Meaning start with your nafs. Then you get to Allah. And it's very clear, you know it very well. I don't need to belabor the point. Afdalul ma'rifa amir al-mu'minin said, ma'rifatul insani nafsuhu. The best form of recognition and ma'rifa is to know yourself. And hence some of the mufassirin of Quran, they said this ma'rifatul nafs is what Allah mentioned in the Quran. Yu'til hikmata man yasha. فَمَنْ يُوتَ الْحِكْمَةِ فَقَدْ أُوتِيَ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. Allah grant wisdom to whomsoever he pleases. And whoever is giving wisdom is be given abundant of khair. They said one of the manifestations of wisdom is to know yourself. If you know yourself, فَقَدْ أُوتِيْتَ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. Since you've been given greatest wisdom, a lot of wisdom. In the same way, أَكْثَرُ النَّاسِ مَعْرِفَةً Amir al-Mu'minin said, أَخْوَفَهُمْ لِلَّهِ. Said the one who's got high level of ma'rifa is the one who's more conscious of Allah. And so therefore, in short, what I'm trying to say is what? This is Sha'baan. It's an opportunity. Don't let it go like that. Work on yourself. Let's challenge ourselves and work on our spirituality. At least we have all these 7 months relaxed, chilling out. This is the time to say, you know what? I'm going to go against my normal routine. And in conclusion, which Allah will grant us tawfiq to discuss, Munajati Sha'baniya is one way to unlock your spiritual potential. This munajat from Mawlai Kainat, Imam Amir al-Mu'minin. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Some narration mention all imams who came after Imam Amir used to recite Munajat Sha'baniya. Kindly, if you have time, be it in English or in Farsi or in Urdu or in Arabic, go through Munajat Sha'baniya. Get some few lines there. It really equips you with mechanisms to understand who you are and to understand your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And lastly, as I mentioned last night, we have this Salawat Sha'baniya, which we recite after every salah. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad shajaratun nubuwa wa mawdi'ur risala wa mukhtalif al-mala'ika wa ahli bayt al-wa'. This dua is from Imam Zain al-Abidin. It's so beautiful how Imam put it. Wa'muru kalbi bi tu'atik wa la tukhzini bi ma'siyatik. Wa'muru kalbi bi tu'atik. Allahu Akbar. Allah, enliven my soul with your obedience. Wa la tukhzini bi ma'siyatik. Allah, do not let me down. Do not put me into shame with my sins. Why can't we ponder and reflect on this dua? These are oceans of spirituality given to us by Ahlul Bayt to prepare for the coming month of Ramadan. So that on that first night when you begin reciting, Allahumma inni aftatihu thana'a bihamdik wa anta musaddidun lissawabi bimannik. Wa aykantu annaka anta arhamur rahimin. You already prepared for it. When you recite on that first day, Allahumma ja'al siyami siyama sa'imin wa qiyami qiyama al-qa'imin. You know what you are doing. Wallah, if you've not prepared, you will not enjoy it. It will be boring and will be counting minutes and hours for iftar. We ask Allah Ta'ala to forgive us, inshallah. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to inspire us with the true teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Ya Allah, this is the holy month of Sha'ban. Make it easy for us to make the best out of this holy month, inshallah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar. Fasalli li rabbika wanhar. Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. Allahumma salli. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين إنه خير ناصر ومعين ثم صلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد اللهم صل وسلم على علي أمير المؤمنين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى الصديقة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى سبتي الرحمة وإمامي الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى علي بن الحسين زين العابدين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والحجة بن الحسن القائم المنتظر عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وسهل الله مخرجا اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد اللهم إنا نرغب إليك في دولة كريمة تعز بها الإسلام وأهله وتذل بها النفاق وأهله وتجعلنا فيها من الدعاة إلى طاعتك والقادة إلى سبيلك وترزقنا بها كرامة الدنيا والآخرة إنك أنت الأعز العجل الأكرم برحمتك يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. Inshallah, in the second sermon, very briefly, I first admonish myself and each and every one of you, mu'mineen and mu'minat, to have the consciousness of the teachings of Almighty Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. One thing which I want to reiterate and also shed light on is the question of khums, which we discussed some other week. And of course, some of the mu'mineen had so many questions to ask about that. You know, as I mentioned, the mas'ala is very clear from Ayatollah Sayyid Ali Sistani, Qaddasallahu Atala Umrahu. Aga Sistani is of the view that, and this is his fatwa. Say for instance, I'm talking about this year, 2019. You have a debt of £50,000.
And then your profit of this year, 10,000, 15,000, 20,000. There is no homes on that 15,000, 20,000. But as I explained clearly, so this debt is something which you need in your life. Like it's a car that you are paying, you've not yet finished paying. It's a house mortgage. So there is no homes on that until the moment your profit become more than your debt. When profit become more than your debt, you pay the debt, the remaining balance, you give homes out of it. Now there is even another one which is much higher than this from Agassistani. I have an example. Say for instance, this year, 2019, you owe 50,000 pounds. It's an example. And then your profit this year is 10,000 pounds. Obviously, there is no homes on that 10,000 based on this fatwa. There's no homes, nothing to worry about. But this 10,000, you keep it with you. Whether you want to invest, whatever up to you, but you keep it. Next year, 2020, you still owe 50,000. And then the 10,000 is still there. Listen very carefully, kindly. Then you decide to use the 10,000, whatever, food, to buy clothes, whatever. Then at the end of 2020, you look at yourself, you have 60,000. But already you have spent this 10,000. This 10,000 is gone. But at the end of the year, 2020, you've got how much? 60,000. Now you owe 50, isn't it? So you lose 50 to serve the debt. What will remain? There is no homes on that 10. Why? Because the 10 you spent, it was not homes due. So he said, use that 10 to replace that 10. You get the fatwa? You've understood the fatwa? So that 10,000 you've just spent, he said, okay, 60. So it means there is 10. Unless if it is 15, 65. So this 10 that you spent in that year was supposed to be spent last year. But you decide to spend this year. So you take it back last year. And this 10 is another 10 which is free. So that is the fatwa. And the aim of this fatwa is, inshallah, I will keep explaining this bit by bit. And if you have any question, feel free to stop me. Agassistani is trying to make it easy for those who are struggling, especially in the West, whereby sometimes people have got mortgages, they're struggling, they're suffocated, paying becomes very difficult. So these fatwas are there just to make life easy for all of us. But of course, if you don't have any mortgage that you are serving, you just normal renting, obviously you have to pay the homes. And say for instance you have the money and you decide to invest the money on something else, and that something else is giving you different business, different profit, that's a different masala altogether. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to forgive us, inshallah. And of course Al Jazeera reported and some other news outlet what happened in Kuwait, the Hazara community have been attacked. We condemn that and we ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to make it easy for them, inshallah. Whatever they are going through, they've been suffering a lot, these Hazara people. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to intervene on their behalf, inshallah. And also we have our mother who is not been well, and she asked us for dua. Ya Allah, make it easy for her, inshallah. And Mullah Qasam also lost his sister-in-law in Orlando. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala forgive her and grant her Jannat al-Firdaus. All mu'mineen who are traveling for ziyara or they're going somewhere during this Easter holiday, may Allah make it easy for them in their trips and bring them back safely, inshallah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar fa salli li rabbika wanhar. Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun ala al-mursaleen. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala